Welcome back to the Hearthstone Championship Tour Winter Americas Championship. I'm here at the sidebar, and I'm joined by Sottl and Rain. And I want to get your guys' thoughts really quickly on the day so far. Anything really stand out and surprise you, Sottl?
I love seeing Anyfin Paladin. It's such an awesome deck to watch. Such polarizing matchups, as we talked about a lot. That's definitely my high point for the day so far.
And Raynad, you, anything that stands out to you on the day so far?
Yeah, I enjoyed the Anyfin deck. I think it was really cool that we saw Handlock. Of all the possible Warlock decks to bring, you know, people expect a lot of Zoo, maybe a bit of Reno, but you know, that's a really cool version of Warlock to bring. So happy to see that from Talion. And yeah, we've seen more Control War than Patron, which has also been surprising.
Yeah, and two sort of really different matchups we've seen already. So I'm really looking forward to the rest of the day, but it's time to head over to Group B. So we're going to introduce the players for the matchup. Player number one is hailing from Long Island, New York. It is going to be Bill. And Bill is a popular streamer on the Chinese streaming service, DouYuTV. So he sort of comes in here as a celebrity, but not one that a lot of people are used to seeing.
Yeah, not too familiar to the Western scene, but a huge impact on in the Eastern scene. Ton of viewers, like you said, on his stream. So while he may be a lesser known name over here, he moved over to America in 2008. So still very strong connections with the Eastern scene and a much bigger name over there.
Yeah, and he tends to be a player that plays a lot of control. So we'll have to see what he's going to bring for this tournament. But his opponent, also in Group B, it is going to be Al Skyhigh. And Al Skyhigh is actually sort of a community member of Bill's stream.
Wow.
So it's kind of an interesting dynamic between these two. They're good friends. They sat together at the prelims and talked a lot to each other. So it's sort of like mentor and apprentice sort of thing going on. So it's really cool to see. And Raina, does that play in? I don't know if you have experience probably playing against people that are your fans, or you know, as a popular streamer. Do you ever get nervous that one of the people that watches you play a lot will understand your playstyle and beat you in a match?
Oh, I lose to my viewers all the time on stream, TJ. It's nothing new. It's I mean, it's cool. That's the beautiful thing about Hearthstone is like if you have all this experience in the world, it definitely like helps and everything. But anybody can win at the end of the day, and it's great to see in tournament plays. You know, nobody's ever out of it.
Yeah, you say you lose to your viewers all the time, but they weren't your viewers until they queued into you, right? So
that depends entirely on whether I'm winning.
Okay, fair enough.
All right, well, we talked a little bit about how these guys are pretty close friends with each other, but we'll see what they had to say about going up against one of their close friends before their match.
My first opponent this weekend is Skyhigh. We know each other pretty well, I think.
We are good friends, and we are from the same hometown, Nanjing, China. WTIBL rarely make mistakes. I think he's a very professional player and very strong. He's my favorite streamer, and I almost only watch him.
I know Skyhigh watches my stream, but I'm not worried about it, because I will try to play perfectly that he will not find a mistake.
There's no secret to challenge him, because he plays many different kinds of decks and it's hard to counter him.
He's a very good player. Sometimes we practice together and we discuss something together.
We support each other. I'm not gonna be afraid of him. I actually don't want to play against him. You know, if I want to play against him, that would be like the final match against each other. That would be like sort of my dream.
I feel good to play against him, not too bad, because there are two players gonna make it to the next step, so I think we two will do.
Al Skyhigh would like the opportunity to play against Bill in the finals, have that kind of final boss moment. It would be really fitting as someone who watches the stream a lot, but he's going to get to play him here, so this is something. And, you know, hopefully, as Bill said, they can both advance, and a very close friendship seems to have developed over their time here. So, Savitz, do you ever play against any of your fans on stream?
Sure, I've played a lot against my viewers, and I don't know. I have the feeling that sometimes the viewers might know the strategies that I like to play better than I know their strategies. So in this situation, who knows? So maybe there's an advantage here for Skyhigh knowing Bill's tendencies maybe better than Bill knows his.
Are you suggesting some sort of lack of competitive integrity when it comes to watching people stream?
No.
He would never.
Corey, you also stream. I have a fairly popular stream as well. It's a popular stream. It's
popular among the 20 people who watch me. For them, I'm very popular.
I am one of them, and I love watching a stream. But you occasionally play against viewers. Mm-hmm. Is that something where you feel like that they have the edge because they've watched you play for so long?
I mean, yeah, a little bit. But you know what? The tendency to play on stream, you actually play very differently than you do in tournament play. It's more casual on stream. You're doing many things at one time. You're reading chat as well as, you know, playing songs and then actually playing games. It's not always the same mindset, really. So I don't actually think it's that advantageous to be the person who watches the stream in this situation.
Right. We see Alsky High bringing Druid, Paladin, Warlock, and Warrior. Bill bringing Druid, Mage, Warrior, and Warlock. And Bill has chosen to ban out Sky High's Druid, and Sky High has chosen to ban out Warlocks. Speeds, what do you make of the bans?
Yeah, I mean, those are some solid bans right there. A little bit of difference there in the lineups that, with that one deck. They're sharing three different classes. We don't exactly have the information how much these guys know about each other's like exact lists. Like, do they know that, for example, does Sky High have the information that Bill is likely to play a Control Warrior and not Patrons? We don't know. But yeah, let's see.
And we can see from, as you pointed out, Bill has those kind of Control Elements card, Jeskar, True Heart, pretty much a dead giveaway of what he's playing. And
yep.
Sky High now, he could be playing more of that mid-range. He could be playing Secret Paladin. Mid-range is very, very popular, it seems, still, as a Paladin deck archetype outside of the States. You know, we occasionally see it, especially from South American players. We sometimes see it, you know, from Chinese and players from Asia Pacific. So I wouldn't be too surprised. But in this matchup, if it is the more mid-range Paladin against Control Warrior, you have to think the mid-range Paladin has the upper hand, I would say.
It's not a crushing
advantage necessarily. But if it's Secret Paladin versus Control Warrior, Cora, what do you make of that as our resident Secret Paladin expert?
Oh, we're bringing that back. The Secret Paladin, I would say, is slightly favored against the Control Warrior. If the Warrior is that sort of removal Warrior that's very popular right now with double revenge, double bash, double brawl, then the Warrior actually has a really good shot. But if it's just traditional, and if your hand looks like you're the Paladin, the Warrior's got a really good chance right now.
Yeah, I think that no matter, based on those three cards that we saw from Sky High in the Mulligan, it was already kind of clear to me that was like, in my opinion, that the Paladin will be favorite, no matter what exact list he's running. But with that type of starting hand, I think Bill is looking quite good if Sky High draws some blanks.
That said, Sky High did not draw some blanks. He gets that shielded minibot. That's a great card to have on turn two. Haunted Creeper, both solid options. Now, you're looking at playing either of these two, and they're two very solid options. What is the consideration, Savitz, between playing something like the Haunted Creeper or the Shielded Minibot?
Well, both of those minions do survive the Fiery War Axe, which probably, if he had, a Knife Juggler in his hand, he would have went for either a Shielded Minibot or a Creeper instead of that. But I believe in this particular situation, he's going for the Minibot mostly, so that it deals more damage, because you do want to be the aggressor, so having two power instead of one power, there is a difference there.
Sure, makes sense, and we'll see what he gets here. Okay, so things are starting to line up a little bit better for Sky High after an opening hand, which if he gets to the mid game, and it looks like he probably will playing against Control Warrior, it's going to be a really solid spot, and Ragnaros is one of those cards that for a long time wasn't necessarily in Secret Paladin, if this is in fact what it is, but it was kind of added as his tech option to give the deck a little bit more bite. Cora, when are you necessarily looking to play that Ragnaros? Is it one of those things where just as soon as turn 8 rolls around, or maybe end of the game?
It's tough to say. When you've got Rag up against Tyrion, especially against Warrior, Tyrion's going to be your turn 8 play, you know, 99% of the time. It's more defensive, much harder for the Warrior to remove. Ragnaros is a lot better in Mage matchups, actually. It gives the Secret Paladin actually a decent shot against the Freeze Mage. If you've also got that Lotheb, maybe an Owl Tech, I would guess this is Secret Paladin, just because we haven't, even though we haven't seen a Secret, these are all cards that are relatively common in the Secret Paladin deck. In this case, the Tyrion will be better than the Rag, but it's just nice for the Paladin to have some other late game.
Yeah, I wouldn't say that it's impossible that this is something else than a Secret Paladin. Because we have seen 8 cards and now 9 out of the Paladin deck, and not a single Secret or a Challenger. And there's an egg, so it's going to be some kind of egg Paladin. I'm really excited to see what else is in there.
This is really cool.
So, Beats, when you and I cast together, there's just like 100% chance every Paladin is egg Paladin. So, this is why I'm glad we cast together so much. But yeah, we see there the Kazan Mystic also comes out of the Deathlord. So Sky High playing with that tech cards, and that's really not uncommon. And I want to kind of point that out, especially in the Chinese scene. And Al Sky High is a Chinese American player. He tends to practice a lot with players like Neability, players like Silent Storm. He's part of this group that's called the QQ Group, and they talk a lot. Bill's in it as well. So they talk a lot about kind of deck strategies, what they want to be playing. And it's not uncommon for them to bring like 1 to 2 tech cards per deck, because those swing cards are often the ones that give you the big advantages. We saw, obviously, Harrison provided huge advantage for Amnesiac against Talion.
Yeah, I'm also under that impression that the Chinese players and like in that type of community, they do prefer those cards more than the Westerns do. So we'll see. Here, turn 5, just the one drop and hero power. Yeah, it's extremely weak.
That said, let's talk about, since I think Egg Paladin is kind of more akin to mid-range Paladin until we see some secrets, I think that's how we probably have to look at it. Yeah. Mid-range Paladin is favored against Control Warrior. Koro, why is that?
You know what? Honestly, it's just because of hero powers. In the late game, the Paladin hero power is so much stronger than the Warrior hero power, and if the Warrior is not able to consistently remove the recruits, then they can just build up and deal so much more damage than the Warrior is able to handle.
Right. Those kind of matches often will end in fatigue, where the Paladin just, you know, consistently does increasing intervals of damage based on, as you said, the hero power, the Silverhand recruit that the Paladin can muster there without using muster.
The Paladin can muster.
Right. Bill does have the ability to go ahead and swing the Deathbite. That will activate the power. would make a 2-1 Dragon Whelpling, though, so it's something he's being considerate of. But we see his hand is just full of removal, which kind of leads me to believe it might actually be that more removal-oriented style of Control Warrior, which kind of leverages Elise in the end of the game to kind of win it out. As he is pondering that Bash.
Yeah, I think you go for the full clear here. With that Bash and the weapon, he can fully clear the board. And seeing that Egg, he knows that there's probably going to be a lot of buffs for it for the Egg, so it's really nice to clear it fully.
Right, and we see he's going for that line of play. He's going to go ahead and make the Dragon, who is unfortunately going to be born just in time.
Darn.
To be killed.
What a short life.
Brian Kibler somewhere very upset watching as dragons are just put down. But
Abusive Sergeant.
Certainly not the card he was hoping to draw.
No, not on turn 6.
Abusive Sergeant, as a rule, tends to work better when you have something on the board to kind of bequeath that bonus.
Generally, that's what you like to do with it.
Right, and not surprising to see it. You know, when you have those egg cards, it's one of those things where you want to, you know, obviously boost up the eggs, give them the ability to attack, and then trade into things. It's pretty much a staple of Zoo. That's how that works.
He's just going to go ahead and play that Abusive Surge, and the buff getting wasted here, but it's still better than nothing. And he has the following turns pretty well set up with that Dr. Boom and the Tyrion Forging.
Yeah, definitely a couple of dead turns, but Bill has a lot of really nice removal in his hand, so even the Dr. Boom, Tyrion Rag coming up, Bill will probably be able to counter them pretty simply.
Well, that said, Tyrion does actually tend to give Warriors fits, and that's kind of what factored into the bad matchup for the Control Warrior, is the Divine Shield usually obviously requires its own source of damage. So the Warrior has to look at using multiple sources of damage to deal with it. They're also forced to deal with an Ashbringer unless they have the Acidic Swamp Ooze, unless they have the Harrison. Ragnaros, yeah. You know, it's just pretty much you play down Ragnaros. Ragnaros can be easily removed by Shield Slam, Big Game Hunter, but yeah, that Tyrion's going to represent a problem for Bill and really this style of deck in general.
Yeah,
Tyrion's
absolutely
very annoying.
Yeah.
I mean, Bill's got the two revenges in hand, so he could even go ahead and play one revenge to get rid of that Divine Shield. And we see the Harrison Jones coming into Bill's hand.
Now, that is an answer for the Aspringer right there. Harrison Jones, just perfect. He will not only be able to destroy the Aspringer from the Tyrion Forging on the following once it gets played, but he will also draw 3 cards.
Right. You see that Nerubian Egg come into Al Sky High's hand, so this is very much reminiscent of that deck that Yombre brought. We saw the Blessing of Kings earlier, so Yombre, if you're watching, you're a trendsetter, you're an innovator. Everybody loves you. Thank you for bringing Egg Paladin to your preliminary.
Thank you for putting Nerubian Egg into your Paladin.
Thank you for, yeah, well, one thing Bill's not going to be thankful for is the ominous laugh of Dr. Boom. Dr. Boom is in the building. He's, you know, making house calls. And it doesn't actually look like, you know, see the Shield Slam, but the bombs represent this kind of, you know, do you revenge them? Do you get rid of them? Is revenge something you save? What do you guys think? Would you waste a revenge to deal with the Boombots, or is that even a waste?
I would certainly play one of those here. If he only had one revenge in his hand, I think that would be more of a consideration. Like, oh, maybe I want to hold on to it for later, but since he has to, I don't think there's any real problem with just doing it. But he still needs to also Shield Slam the Dr. Boom. Or try to brawl.
Yeah, that could be an issue now.
In that case, no revenge required.
If you do not sequence this correctly, And the Boombots hit for, you know, upwards of 3 or 4 damage, and then suddenly you can't shield slam off Dr. Boombot.
3 or 4 damage? These Boombots are hitting for 8.
Fair point. I've seen you run into some Boombots in your time.
There you go. Yeah. 8 damage.
Double force. Wow.
Wow. you are gaining caster powers more quickly
Thank
than I'm
you.
Comfortable with.
I am a prophet. No, but it's actually interesting that Bill decided to go with the Brawl here. Most likely he's got another one in the deck, like the Double Revenge. Just decided, want to save the Shield Slam, basically.
Yeah, it's quite common to see do Brawls nowadays. It's almost a standard.
Yeah, Brawl there has the best possible outcome in terms of what it removed. Not in terms of what the Boombots did, because they were pretty mean-spirited, but Alskyheim might feel comfortable just dropping down the Ragnaros, because as you can see here, this would put the Ragnaros hit would put Bill with no armor. So it would play around a possible Shield Slam, which we do see in Bill's hand. Might just decide to go with that Tyrion, though, for reasons we've already talked about it. Unfortunately, Bill has that Harrison.
Put your faith in the light.
Put our faith in the light. Tyrion Fordring hits the board, and Skyhigh's going to be feeling pretty confident here. Korra, as you said, you play down the Tyrion first before the Ragnaros. It just represents more value. How bad does it feel, though, on a 1 to 10 scale, when your Ashbringer is put into Harrison Jones Museum?
Well, we're talking 1 to 10. It's,
yes.
It's pretty high. I would say it's like a 9. It would be a 10, except Skyhigh still has that Ragnaros to follow up. So he's like, okay, that was bad. The museum just got one more, you know, one more weapon, but I can throw the Ragnaros down the next turn. That's still a nice big minion. And that's why you have the Ragnaros in the deck,
right,
is because when you have, if this does have secrets, which at this point we're thinking maybe it does not, then you've got the 7-8-9, or the 7-8-9 curve, which is still just another 8-mana minion. But it gives you more staying power in the late game, which is something that you need against the Control Warrior, which has that staying power ingrained in the deck.
That said, once this deck runs out of threats, the Control Warrior, I mean, this is exactly what plays into the win condition, right? Like, you just run him out of threats, eventually armor up out of range. I mean, you can beat him in Fatigue, you can beat him with Elise. Right, so we are going to see the Ashbringer come out, and wow, he's going to get a charge off of that.
I'm a little bit surprised that he just went for the weapon attack right there. He could have maybe waited with that and... Okay, let's see how it works out. Harrison Jones certainly gonna come from Bill next turn, but Sky High here with a few options. I don't really see any issues with just dropping the Rag.
I don't see an issue with that, or even just dropping the Nerubian and Hero Powering, since you do have the Blessing of Kings next turn, you have the Keeper of Aldemon, so you can just buff it up to a 3-3, and then actually put the Blessing of Kings on it. I think maybe Sky High might consider the fact that this is kind of the last of his big threats, right? So since you're not running Challenger, this is kind of one of those things where once it comes down, if it gets removed, it could be a thing where you're in a really bad situation. So I think I kind of like this play, but I also see the validity. And again, just jamming down Ragnaros. A Shield Slam is probably not going to come out to kill it.
None.
Wow, now that's interesting.
Yeah, I like playing the Keeper of Uldemon here.
Sure.
It sets up such a huge board. And Sludge Belcher, but that's going to be another 5 mana. And he only has 4 remaining after the Harrison Jones, so not going to be able to play that just yet.
He does pick up that Execute, which is going to allow him to kill the Ragnaros pretty easily, though. That was actually something that he was going to have a problem with. If Skyhigh chose to play the Rag last turn, he did not have an automatic kill for it, so that Execute going to come in really handy.
Drawing the Execute right there is such a huge deal. Ragnaros that doesn't get dealt with adds up to a lot of damage quite quickly.
Right, so let's look at this. You know, we go back to the idea again that at any time he can just jam down that Ragnaros, and he has the mana to do it. He can even make a Silverhand Recruit as well to accompany it. But do you maybe use this Consecration to help deal with Harrison Jones, since you don't necessarily want to use Blessing of Kings into it? And it's one of those things where maybe you figure you're not going to get too much value out of Consecration against a Control Warrior.
No, I think the Kings on the egg and just use that to clear off the Harrison is perfect. The egg still survives at 4 and 1. Even if there was a way to deal one more damage to it, it would still come back as a 4-4. So this creates a really awkward board.
And it makes it a little bit harder for Bill to clear the board, makes it more Brawl resistant, which is, Skyhigh has to know that Bill is running 2 Brawls at this point. It's really common for this warrior type. So choosing not to kill off the egg gives him something that's going to stick around if the second Brawl is in Bill's hand.
Yep, definitely. And second Belcher, Korra, what do you think about just double Belchers here? Kind of like defensively, or is it time for the last revenge? Or?
It's okay. Skyhigh can clear them off just with his board. He has some resistance. Yeah, going with the Grom is okay. It's basically saying, I want to save, you know, my Belchers so I can clear off more of your board with just this one card, but it's sacrificing that much damage.
Oh my, he has actually... Wow, that Ragnaros with the abusive...
Oh,
he can take a coin flip here to either win the game or just kill off the Rag. I think that's a win-win situation.
Either you kill Grom and save your board or you just win.
Yeah.
All right, I really like I like the coin flip in this situation. The Warrior sells a lot of cards. You understand what kind of Warrior you're dealing with at this point. What point do you think your window of opportunity to win this game closes? And Ragnaros is one of those answers where I think now if you can do it, you go for it. And let's see if he does. Let's see if he doesn't clear this.
One damage off lethal without the Rag.
Right. All right, let's see. Ragnaros Firelord deals 8 damage to a random target. We'll see if it's Bill or Grom. Oh, and Grom goes down. This is still not terrible, though, because we don't see a second Brawl. So we won't use a lot of resources. And I actually am not sure. No,
but Bill's Revenge deals 3 damage now. He can clear everything except for the Nerubian and throw out the Sludge Belcher. Or even the Shield Maiden if he'd just rather do that.
Damage boost on that Revenge so huge.
Right, we can look at that last play from Sky High and be like, oh, well, you know, it's a little too much leaving it to chance, but I really like that. I think anytime you just immediately have a 50% chance to win the game, I think you just go for it, especially in a situation where the window is just getting closed or it's closing more and more each turn.
Absolutely. I mean, that's such a great opportunity. Absolutely right play from Sky High to go for that. Bill just happened to have the best answers possible to it.
Right, and I think Sky High probably also understood that that was kind of an all-in sort of play, to where if he overcommitted, Bill was going to use any of his premium removal cards just kind of equalize the board. But he's not in a terrible spot right now either.
I think he's in a pretty terrible spot.
It's all right, bad now. It's bad now.
Why am I wrong?
Because Bill has so much potential with his hand. He's got 10 health coming from the Shield Maidens, a slam for cycle and removal, that hero power that's naturally just going to make him incredibly tough to kill, especially if he draws Justicar coming up, not to mention the Sludge Belcher, which is a taunt, and the Gore Howl, which is, as we saw with the Amnesiac versus Talion game, just so, so good in control matchups.
I think it's a really huge deal that most of Sky High's big minions are already played too. There's not really that many great top decks unless he has spiced up the usual Paladin with something special like
Ysera.
Yeah, but it's extremely unlikely.
Now, as a trade in that A3 Nerubian feels awful. Savitz feels bad, man, as one of your emotes would say. And Lothep comes down and this could be the start of a comeback. Lothep obviously limits options, but can't necessarily lean on that too heavily.
Yeah, he needs something a little bit more. Bill here looking at a Shield Maiden and potentially Death Spite, but very likely he wants to get that armor up to go with the Shield Maiden. I wouldn't blame him for playing the Death Spite, though, because Shield Maiden does provide that 5 armor already.
Right, you could also well, no, you can't even Shield Slam here because you'd need more mana, or more armor rather, so. You could equip the Gore Howl, but as you guys pointed out, it's kind of one of those things where you go really low. And yes, you know Sky High is living off the top of his deck, but it still doesn't feel great. Cora, do you agree with the Shield Maiden Deathspite play?
I like it. You know what? I also don't dislike the Gore Howl hero power because we've seen double Blessing of Kings from Sky High, we've seen double Consecration, and we've already seen one abusive Sergeant. So what damage does he really have coming from hand? A True Silver?
Yeah, True Silver Champion would actually be exactly lethal, I believe, because he was like 5 from that. So there might be a True Slur. Can't quite remember if he played those cards earlier, but Shield Maiden, in any case, seems like a much safer choice in this situation. Let's see if he wants to pop up the spider. He's gonna go for it.
So Sky High needs 5 damage off the top of his deck.
That's not gonna do it, and it's especially painful to consider playing. I don't think there's any world where you can play it this turn.
There's almost no point in playing it. You do get the weapon, but those 1/1s that spawn from it are completely worthless because that Death Spite from Bill is going to swing on the following turn anyway.
Right, those Silverhand recruits definitely don't want Sky High to play Muster. Like, no, wait, just wait a turn. We'll come out, we promise. But Sky High, you know. This is such a rough spot to be in. I mean, you really can't do anything. The hero power is ultimately pretty much no gain. Muster, no gain. And, you know, 3 cards in Bill's hand, and he's just armoring up every turn. So, rough spot to be in. Bill has done a great job getting through all those big threats of Sky High.
This is very reminiscent of the first game between Chalky and Nostum, where Nostum was playing the Warrior and he was so low on life but just always stayed slightly above where Chalky could deal damage. So Sky High got him so low, but Bill, with that Shield Maiden, the hero power, is just going to be able to stay slightly out of the range where Sky High can kill him.
Right. He puts on a little bit of pressure, chooses to use the Shield Slam, so I can respect that. It's good to get that face damage in there. don't need to be necessarily super conservative again. You've disarmed Sky High pretty much all of his major threats. Whatever that last card in hand is, you're not super scared of it.
Nope. And,
there's a secret.
I think that's going to be a game right there. Yeah. With 10 power on the board and Gora Owl for another
just
7.
17.
Sky High concedes and Bill takes game 1.
Right, so Bill takes that game, again, playing that more removal-heavy warrior. We even see the Gore Howl in the end there. So Gore Howl's a card which has kind of been out of the meta for a while now, but it's starting to kind of make a comeback, at least at this tournament. We've seen Amnesiac run it. We've seen Bill run it now. I'm also just really impressed by the number of control warriors. Really expected more patron, as that's just such a solid class, especially if you're expecting to run into a lot of aggressive decks. Cora, are you surprised by the amount of control warriors here?
I am too. I think this all just says that people were really expecting a control-heavy meta, and the control warrior is... it's always just a solid deck. It's something that you can always choose, and it just always has a chance to win pretty much every matchup. Sort of like that aggro shaman we were talking about.
Right.
It's never completely out of the game, especially this more heavy removal version, which is really strong against aggro and has a decent chance against mid-range decks as well.
Yeah, sure.
Against any control deck, the Gore Howl is a great inclusion. Yeah, it does get destroyed by Harrison Jones potentially, but it still gets to attack once with that 7 attack and deal with one minion at least.
Right, so Bill goes up 1-0 against his fan, Al Sky High, but let's take a little bit closer of a look at Bill and kind of what makes him a popular streamer and what he's about.
My in-game ID is WTY Bill. WTY stands for my Chinese initials, and Bill is my English name. I'm living on Long Island, New York. I play Hearthstone and I want it to be like a competitive level. I think most people like me because, first of all, I don't play bad. And I make jokes sometimes, so I'm funny, maybe. I started my streaming June of 2014. I think it's important for me to be a streamer and also compete in this tournament because streaming makes me a better player. Have better mentality. I don't get nervous when I play in tournaments, and I get more focused. One thing I really love about fan support is they are always waiting for me to stream, like every day. I know the fans are waiting for me, so I'm gonna stream. I won't let them down. So this weekend, I'm gonna prove that you can also be a good streamer and a good player. At the beginning of last year, I was preparing to play competitively for the BlizzCon of last year. But in February, my wife was pregnant, so I gave up playing competitively. I just streamed after my wife gave birth to the baby, and now I have time to compete in tournaments.
当我被问到家人对我是对我打炉石支持多么重要的时候，我实在是无法想象出，如果没有他们支持，我会怎么样？因为 我太太非常支持我打炉石，我打炉石的时候，她有些时候做饭给我吃。Actually, my wife used to play Hearthstone, and our baby, he might play Hearthstone as well in the future. I think I'm a good, strong player because I'm focusing more on details when we play in tournaments. 这个周末如果我能拿到冠军的话，就足够我是非常屌的。I'm WTY Bill. This weekend, I'm going to play perfect games. I will make no mistake.
There you have it, the secret to being liked by people. Don't play bad and be funny sometimes. it worked out for Bill really well. Popular streamer, has an absolutely adorable kid, so good on Bill, and he's up 1-0 in this series, so everything's basically coming up Bill here.
Yeah, some strong words there. I will not make mistakes this weekend.
We'll play perfect games.
Open up the waiting jaws of Twitch chat and climb right in when you say things like that, but obviously, well enough job to go up on this series, and Al Sky High gonna have to kind of, well, the serious challenger, so we know exactly what Secret Paladin, or what kind of Paladin he's playing. To hit Secret Paladin, and Bill's gonna go with the Freeze Mage, and Cora, Secret Paladin versus Freeze Mage. Freeze Mage certainly on paper looks like the more favored deck, but we've seen multiple times over the course of the winter season, you know, where Secret Paladin has eked out a win. What is it gonna take for him to get that win?
It's gonna be tough. The Paladin is definitely unfavored in this matchup, but we saw that Ragnaros. We saw some eggs, which are actually really difficult to remove for the Freeze Mage, make a very sticky board. And then we see Coghammer, which is really nice against the Hero Power. We haven't seen an Owl, which is really something that actually, you know, helps the Paladin get that, even if it's just a 5% more edge, that Owl being able to silence a Doomsayer is really nice. It's going to be tough for Al Sky High, but he does have a chance. This hand is not great. But Bill's hand is also a little bit slow, so anybody's game.
Yeah, that's good. I'm intrigued by the deck from Sky High, because there were so many cards in the previous game where he just didn't find this challenger, mm-hmm. he did not find a single secret, and now it's like, oh, well, okay, so they are in there. So he is definitely running a limited number of secrets and not the usual 7 or 8 that we see quite often.
Right, we didn't see the competitive spirit there, and Sky High just chooses to play it out along with the shielded minibot. So this is kind of a very forward approach here, because you're basically committing to only getting the competitive spirit buff, which is obviously +1/+1 on your minions. You're essentially saying, I'm only going to get it on the shielded minibot. And while it's going to be great for trading with the Acolyte of Pain, Savitz, you look like you're kind of in pain. What are you thinking?
I'm a little bit stunned by that play, like coining out the competitive spirit on one minion. Like, is it worth the coin? Is it worth the competitive spirit? It's like,
in some cases it is, but especially when you're looking at a hand that is this heavy, I just don't know that in the next couple of turns he could have afforded to use that coin so early on.
Not necessarily a mistake, but definitely a tiny bit questionable there. But it's kind of in some ways it worked out, because that one extra toughness and one extra health and attack buff on the mini, but did help him clear that Acolyte without any extra cards being drawn.
Right, and there's kind of some value to be considered in, you know, playing against what you'd expect. So Bill clearly was not expecting. I'm pretty sure if you were to ask Bill, hey, in that moment, what did you think that secret was? He's probably going to tell you Noble Sacrifice, Avenge,
Redemption,
maybe a Redemption because it's shielding Minibot, but he never expected Competitive Spirit. Does allow him to just clearly get rid, or clear, very conveniently get rid of the Acolyte of Pain, so he only gets one card off of it. So have to kind of look at the upside on this one. Mm-hmm. But yeah, looking at Sky High's hand now, he's kind of on an island, from what we can see, until turn 6. You know, he could play the Avenge and the Hero Power. Doesn't really feel super strong. And Bill trying to figure out what exactly he's going to do with this hand. This is a very, very high skill level deck to play. Freeze Mage, Savitz, Doomsayer. What do you think?
Yeah, that's really early. I mean, Doomsayer is such a powerful card in this matchup. Does choose to go with it straight away, and it kind of works out, because that Avenge with the Master for Battle would have been... Hold on. Well, just an Avenge, I would imagine. Yeah. So he's going to play that one, but can't play the Master for Battle now because of the Doomsayer. So it worked out, but Doomsayer is a card, and in this matchup, sometimes it's so valuable that you really, if you have the opportunity, that you want to save it for later use in combination with the First Nova.
It's not usually an early game Doomsayer, whereas like against other decks, you may want to do that against other aggro decks. With the Secret Paladin, they have no way of really, you know, silencing that Doomsayer unless they run an Owl. But so you usually want to save it for later on with Frost Nova, like you were saying, against those huge mysterious challenger boards, Dr. Boom, which we see in Sky High's hand. Reporting
for duty. Yeah, from 6 on, he's got the curve. He's got the dream curve that you just hate running into in ranked play. But again, it's not even really that effective, because what Mysterious Challenger does is sets up a really powerful situation to where your board, by being interacted with, just becomes more powerful, and then you start doing tons of damage. But the Freeze Mage seldom interacts with the board, because it's mostly playing from spells, it's just playing the removal game. So Mysterious Challenger is actually a card where it doesn't do a whole lot against Freeze Mage.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's absolutely true. And the Ragnaros would also be a better turn 8 than the Tyrion Forging is in most cases in this particular matchup. Still having that, so to say, Dr. 6, Dr. 7, Dr. 8 curve, it's not too bad when you're going into those turns.
You know, everyone just suddenly a doctor today. Just ridiculous.
Dr. Hearthstone casting all the doctor matches.
Right, why are they just giving out doctorates, but...
Honorary doctorates, but still.
Right, and we did see the one competitive spirit already played, and generally you're only running one of that. So it's kind of a situation now where... you know pretty much exactly what secrets are coming out, and there's not a lot of wiggle room. And apparently there's no repentance, which is kind of a one-off tech choice, but yeah.
It certainly would be a shocker if those secrets were not exactly Redemption, Noble Sacrifice, and Avenge.
I mean, there's another secret, you know. There's two other secrets
we
don't ever see.
So we could be very surprised, potentially.
I think the eggs are about as surprised as we're going to get with this deck. You
know? Yeah, it would just be very, almost unbelievable if he managed to fit in other secrets as well as the egg text, as well as Abusive Sergeant. I'm very curious on what he took out.
Seems like we haven't seen Shredder.
Mm-hmm.
I want to bring that up. We haven't seen Shredder.
Haven't seen Sludge Belcher. Right. No Owl.
Those kind of core 4 or 5. drops. We haven't been seeing much of it, so.
Yeah, I feel like I want to, after the match, I want to run the math on the draw from Skyhigh in the first game. How many cards can, what are the chances to draw, like, no secrets or challenger in the first 15 cards or so? Because he really didn't see that stuff at all.
I mean, it's clear he's running a Reno deck. There's a Reno in here somewhere, just a one-off of each deck. And, yeah, it's clearly what he's doing. Obviously, that's a joke. You would not ever run Reno in a non-control paladin. Even then, from when we kind of saw a little bit when League of Explorers first came out, it wasn't a super successful deck.
I've tried it a little bit.
You're talking to the Reno yeah. Jackson stream master, Rob.
Savitz is a master of making decks that are Reno, Beast, Pirate, Bug, all kinds of archetypes that aren't discovered.
and then,
Scarab, maybe.
But let's be real. I have to say that the Reno Jackson did not work out so well in an aggressive strategy, so. Oh, no. But probably better off not playing that card.
Right, and Bill just kind of sitting here. He got the value from Emperor Thorzan, trying to figure out what is the exact correct way to navigate this. For him, it's all about clearing up board, eventually maybe using the Alexstrasza to bring the health to 15, chaining some spells together. Alexstrasza is one of the few minions where Noble Sacrifice is kind of important. You tend to see the Noble Sacrifice sits there for a while, and then Alexstrasza comes down and is blocked by it. We'll see the Avenge come out, but it's on the frozen Mysterious Challenger who won't be going anywhere fast.
Yeah, going for that Doomsayer here might potentially allow him to play an empty board. Either Antonidas or an Alexstrasza on next turn.
But it also gives Skyhigh some sense of safety, because now we've seen both Doomsayers come out and Bill doesn't have any other AoE in his hand, so that Dr. Boom, that Tyrion are most likely going to go unanswered.
It's true. His health total is so high, though, that I believe he does not need any more AoE to be able to close out this game. Now, Skyhigh here, he could play the Haunted Creeper, get those 1-1s for next turn. He could also just drop the Tyrion Forging and get that powerful Aspringer weapon.
Right, and you know, Bill claimed he was a player who wasn't going to make any mistakes this time around, but certainly when you're looking at Freeze Mage, there are plays that are strictly speaking wrong. There are a few of those. There are plays that are okay, there are plays that work, and then there's like the most optimal play, and it's super difficult to find in the span of a minute and a half what those plays are. So we did see the Doomsayer come out, but oh wow!
He's gonna go ahead and do what Savitz said, is play that Tyrion Fordring just to get the Ashbringer prepped for next turn.
Has that huge weapon now, but might not be enough. There's the Alexstrasza gonna hit the board. He could even Frostbolt here just to freeze the Aspringer, but having that one mana Frostbolt with the Antonidas on next turn, it's such a nice combination to have.
Right, and now we're all just bringing out our legendaries. You know, here's my Tyrion, here's my Dr. Boom, here's my Alexstrasza, and Nerubian Egg too.
Just for fun.
Good for Nerubian Egg.
Because why not Egg Paladin?
Nerubian Egg hanging out with some important people. So. Now we will see, it looks like, as you said, that Archmage Antonidas.
Yeah, definitely.
The Frostbolt come out. And again, Noble Sacrifice will block Alexstrasza for a turn. It seems a little ridiculous that a tiny little foot soldier drops the aspect of life, but here we are.
No, I mean.
Yeah, and Bill can actually go ahead, play the Frostbolt, and play the Ice Barrier, get himself really very protective so that Skyhigh's just not able to do anything with that board. And this is where the Paladin really struggles against the Freeze Mages, when the board is locked up and when the board is insignificant.
Like, that's so good. Just going for the Ice Barrier. He could Frostbolt he could also Frostbolt the Dr. Boom, but Frostbolting phase is pretty sweet, because then True Silver won't be able to heal. And with those extra fireballs, should be able to close out the game on the next turn, unless there's going to be something like a Lothep and Taunts, or Lothep and Goghammer.
We did see the Lothep in Skyhigh's deck.
That's
but
right.
Even
so
that would only stall for
a
turn.
Yeah, that's true, in this particular instance.
So we see him go ahead and pop the Noble Sacrifice. So he is running Owl. We see one Owl there. But we saw him go ahead and pop the... Okay, never mind. It's not going to matter. Bill's going to go ahead and close out the game, go up 2-0. And Owl Skyhigh, you know, really bad spot here, to be completely honest. Like, doesn't necessarily seem like he has the answers for what Bill's bringing just yet. Have to know, though, Savitz, is there any point to popping that Noble Sacrifice? Is there any upside or downside when you're looking at that last scenario, since you know you have lethal?
I mean, I guess you... No, it doesn't really matter, right? Because you can check what you use. So.
That was actually more obvious for me. I was just curious, but...
I think you could potentially, like, not attack there to play around the Divine Favor if there was a second Noble Sacrifice in the hand, so you could keep the second Noble Sac in the hand. But it's pretty minor. That was such a great matchup. Good for Bill. He got the matchup that he wanted. Definitely a big favorite going up against the Secret Paladin with that Freeze Mage. He was able to take it quite easily.
Right, so Sky High, you know, down 0-2. He's going to have to figure out how he gets back into the series and looks to win. But we had a chance to sit down and talk with him about the QQ discussion group and all of his friends and how much he really wants to make them proud in this series against Bill.
My name is AR Sky High. I'm 21 years old now. Sky High is from a Japanese anime called Bunny and Tiger, and it's a character called Sky High. At first, I played Hearthstone casually, but after I joined the QQ group and meet those professional players, I started to play against them and beat them, and that gave me a lot of confidence to play competitively. A QQ discussion group is where the Chinese American players join together and communicate and practice together. In the discussion group, for the winter preliminary, there is a guy helped me to prepare decks called BB Gangang, which really helps me to get qualified. So that gave me lots of confidence, and I think, yeah, I can do this. So I practice every day, and I do nothing except Hearthstone, actually. My family support me for playing this Hearthstone. When my father heard that I got qualified from the winter preliminary, he's so surprised. And you know, he's a very traditional person, and he even said like, what game is this? I'm gonna download and play it too. In order to play against my opponent, I need to play perfectly this weekend because they are very strong and hard to make mistakes, so I have to be as better as I can to beat them. Winning this tournament is really important to me because in the 1,000 people QQ discussion group, they will be very proud of me. I'm all Sky High. I'm gonna win this tournament to make my QQ group proud.
Great to hear people getting together and kind of having these groups that they can talk to about Hearthstone, about, you know, hobbies and other things they're doing with their lives, and come together and not only talk necessarily like deck techs and kind of what decks they'll be bringing to tournaments, but, you know, just having that group of friends that you can talk to on the regular and hang out with is really awesome. And, you know, Sky High, his huge motivation here is to get in there and represent the QQ discussion group and really make them proud. Sabiz, I know you have a group of people, obviously, with Team Liquid, that you're constantly talking to, you're practicing with. Do you feel it makes the game kind of more an enriching experience when you have that group of people you can talk to regularly?
Sure, and for like preparing for tournaments like this, I think one of the key things is to kind of like get through the bad ideas quickly and figure out what exactly the other ones are going to be playing. No, I'm not kidding. You're laughing there. But actually, once new expansions arrive and stuff, you're gonna be trying to make new creative strategies. And speaking of creative strategies, we have Kel'Thuzad here for Bill.
I'm right. So happy to see a Kel'Thuzad in a Druid deck. That is something we rarely ever see, but it works so well with the taunt minions. I love it.
Yeah, Zombie Chow in there too, and that was a card that we did see for a while, really prior to Darnassus Aspirant, mm-hmm. Living Roots, and it helped kind of bring the early game board to heal when you're playing against more aggro decks. But this is something, as you said, we see Harrison Jones, Kel'Thuzad, Zombie Chow. Cora, what do you make of this Druid deck?
It's interesting. It's definitely straying from the Druid deck that we normally see, which I like. And we see the same trend a lot with these Chinese American players. More of the Eastern scene takes risks, like we've seen with this Egg Paladin. So it's something that might actually give them an advantage against the other players, the North American and South American players that tend to stick with the same decks, the same things that we've already seen. And these surprises are so, so pivotal.
Yeah, it's almost like set in stone that if you see a Druid player, you know it's going to be a double combo. But Bill here bringing something completely different, I think that's very cool. We have not seen a Kel'Thuzad in competitive events in a very, very long time.
Wow, so he goes ahead, he pops the egg. Let's see if he rats for one or three. Okay, so he goes ahead and does that, uses the hero power, and that just takes out the spider. So didn't really have another good play otherwise, so now he has gotten everything off the board. And, you know, to your point about this idea of what you kind of expect when you see tournaments and established decks, there is something to be said about having a deck that nobody expects, that you're very comfortable with, that's a list that you understand, because Hearthstone is just very much a different game when your opponent has no idea what's in your hand.
That is true, and another big thing here is that because Sky High says that he's kind of like a little bit fan of a Bill stream. Where has seen Bill play this type of druid and can figure it out where some other players maybe couldn't.
That's absolutely something to be considered of. Bill on 5 has Sludge Belcher and Druid of the Claw, so between that and the Kel'Thuzad, I have to think this is a more defensive deck, kind of designed to deal with the more aggressive setups. And Kel'Thuzad is one of those minions where if you've never actually seen it played, if it comes down and manages to resurrect, you know, 2 to 3 minions, it's just so much value. Saviz, your face just lighting up. What?
That's such a bad draw. It's the only competitive spirit in the deck. It was Skyhive was certain to point out that Challenger there, it seemed by far the best, like, the best play, and drawing that only competitive spirit. Not only does he not get it to the board for free, but he also, like, you know, missed out on a draw, yeah.
Right, so we enter the turn now where Bill has to kind of figure out how to disarm the Challenger.
There's a card that's pretty good at it if the Challenger was to get to 7 attack, but
it usually does. I mean, it's almost like the Avenge is sort of magnetic to the mysterious Challenger. But even if it's not, if it goes on to that Shielded Minibot, Keeper of the Grove is pretty nice here. Druid of the Claw, not bad. Bill has a couple of options, at least.
Yeah, like that Infobox said, WTY, Bill has very high win rate on his druid, but the win rate here with that trying to buff that mysterious challenger for the big game is only 33%, so he might not go for it. For no
one. I'm just so curious to see what else is in this druid list, because with Kel'Thuzad, you can make serious, you know, zero combo, just taunt druid decks that run, like, you know, Senjin Shieldmaster with double Sludge Belchers, the Druid of the Claws, and I mean, that takes full advantage of the Kel'Thuzad. I have to imagine in this case there is combo in the list, but I mean, we just don't really know at this point.
The buff does not go on the Challenger, but that means it's not all bad, because it does mean that the Keeper of the Grove is going to get decent value on the Shielded Mini, but not only removing the buff, but also the Divine Shield at the same time.
Interesting that he chose to put the Zombie Chow into Sky High's face there. Do you think it's just because the timer was running down, or...?
I'm not sure. Yeah. I kind of feel like I would have liked the trade.
I would have liked to put it into the Shielded Minibot. Yeah. I don't know. I would think that's probably just because there was the time pressure with the rope.
Oh, is this the... But Bill said he would not do any mistakes.
Now, so we have to assume that was
that
the
was
correct play,
yes,
then.
He did it on purpose?
Get that 2 damage in there. Yeah. Sky High, on the other hand, in a spot where he's got a second Challenger he can play down and probably get a second Avenge out of that, maybe a second Noble Sacrifice. Probably not going to see the other Redemption, not going to see any other competitive spirit, as we didn't see the first one come out. Korra, when it comes to putting together secrets for Secret Paladin, what are you generally looking for? Like, what's the optimal balance in your experience?
The optimal balance for the traditional Secret Paladin, I like... double Avenge, double Noble Sacrifice, 1 Redemption, 1 Competitive Spirit. So generally a 6 Secret Bundle. With a deck like this, slightly different with all the Nerubian Egg, Dragon Egg, I could even see a second Competitive Spirit being a viable option because you need procs on those cards for them to really get value. And also a second Redemption might even be pretty good with the Nerubian and the Dragon Egg. So it's definitely a different setup in this case.
You see that cat come out, it's going to be charged, it's going to deal with the mysterious challenger, and Bill just pretty much on cleanup duty right now, trying to get to the point where things get late enough to where he can put down that Kel'Thuzad with other minions, get that value, and look to win the game through that, as opposed to, I would assume this deck doesn't run Force of Nature Savage Roar combo.
Probably not. How do you fit in those cards if you're running Kel'Thuzad? Because if you have a Kel'Thuzad, then it's very likely there's also going to be some huge taunts like Ancient of War.
It's possible that it's a single combo druid, but
that could be one combo, yeah.
Just so unusual nowadays.
Right, we've seen 2 copies of Druid of the Claw, 2 copies of Sludge Belcher, so we know those are in there. Have to think Azure Drake's probably not in this list. Mm-hmm. These are kind of the cards you switch out when you go for these different builds. And actually, our host, Frodan, has been experimenting with druid decks of late, too. Been catching his stream, and he's been doing the Naga Siren. He's been playing like Arch Thief Rafam, kind of crazy stuff. So maybe it's just what great Hearthstone minds do.
Yeah, Naga Siren, which is such a fun card. I'm a little bit sad it didn't make its way to competitive play. Might be just a tiny bit too slow, or requires you to have it survive for one turn, which it doesn't do often enough.
Well, we haven't seen Bill's entire deck yet. Don't let your dreams be dashed just yet. But looking at what Bill has, Bill can play down a taunt and then look to hero power unless he's just willing to give up the big game hunter, but it would feel really bad. He could just drop down Kaldazad onto the empty board, but I think we can all agree that none of these choices feel particularly good.
I think I might have liked the Druid of the Claw charge in the 3-4 here, because he does know that it's going to be a competitive spirit, because it did not get, well not guaranteed knows, but he knows that it was in the hand, because it did not get pulled from the mysterious challenger, so it was very likely. So Druid of the Claw charge would have maybe reduce the amount of creatures that are getting buffed. Goghammer from the top. That's
so
such an
strong.
Excellent draw.
No, and Bill's only saving grace in this was if he was able to remove Sky High's field and then his hand runs out. But with such efficient cards like the Coghammer, the second Mysterious Challenger, even that Owl will come in really very handy on these taunt minions. I don't see that happening anytime soon. Bill's hand is just so short on that removal that he really needs. Swipe, Big Game Hunter just slightly out of reach here with that Lotheb. Just seems really unlikely at this point.
Yeah, the Owl would kind of work here, I suppose. You could get through that taunt, but you could also save it for later on in case there's even a bigger taunt coming up.
I kind of like Owling here because that's going to let you do a bunch of damage to the face. You equip the Cog Hammer. It's very difficult to remove. I had, Cora, you laugh, but I had an explanation. It was more just the face damage. You equip that Cog Hammer. It's difficult to get through the other minions and get rid of them. So you're just pushing a lot of damage at this point. He actually plays down the Mysterious Challenger with it, and that's just another big 6-6. And yeah, Bill would need
There's
to draw
lot of damage.
Some combination of cards that are probably not in the deck.
And that's not one of them.
No secrets getting pulled out, so we know that he's only running one copy of Noble Sacrifice and Avenge in that case.
Right, we were talking about what you have to cut to make the eggs work, and it seems like you just trim down on the secrets a bit. And the I think it's safe to say at this point we don't expect any Shredders.
Yeah.
So.
I don't hate cutting the second Noble Sacrifice, but personally I think that Avenge is one of those secrets that are kind of good enough to get played just on their own, even without an Avenge.
Especially in this egg-type deck.
Such a powerful thing to have to those, but it's an interesting list, and it's cool to see that players are doing it differently and not just like copying other people's decks and not trying to like think on their own.
Right, so Sky High gonna get ahead and get on the board. He's gonna go ahead and get that win, which is very important. Bill still just has to win with that Druid deck. Although, we talked about, the idea of having to win just one game with Druid. When you have the Force of Nature Savage War combo deck, it kind of almost feels inevitable that at some point you're gonna have that big turn where you have the combo and you win it out. But with Bill running this more creative version of Druid, it's, I think looking at Warlock and Paladin, or Warlock and Warrior left for Sky High, it's a lot less certain.
Yeah, I mean, playing Warrior against a greedy Druid, that seems like it might be some rough times, but we'll see how it plays out.
Especially with a more taunt-heavy Druid list, very difficult for the Warrior to get through. The Warlock, if it's a Zoo list, also might be a little bit more unfavored for the Warlock. Zoo would still be definitely favored against the Druid, but with that a little bit more greedy, we see the Zombie Chows would definitely help out, so... I'm just excited to see more of what Bill has in his deck at this point.
Yeah.
Right, and we want to hear what you at home think. Is Bill going to go ahead and close out with this wacky Druid deck, or is Sky High going to complete the counter-reversal there and go ahead and claim the series? Tweet using HCT, and then also vote using the hashtag AllSkyHigh or hashtag WTYBill. So right now, I got to think Bill still feels like he's in the driver's seat here.
Definitely.
We're just needing the one more win, but Sky High has to believe... Well, and that's the thing, right? Actually, it's hard to predict what he believes. Does he know? You know, he saw a lot of the classic Druid cards in there with the exception of Zombie Chow. Never saw Kaldazad, so Bill still might have a little bit of the upper hand in terms of information, but we see there that Ancient of War, Savitz, you mentioned.
Yeah, that's certainly a powerful card. Warrior does have the tools to deal with it in form of Execute, which gives the Warrior player some great tempo. I'm also excited to see if Sky High has made some more unique choices in his Warrior deck, because we did see those... kind of out of meta eggs in the Paladin.
The Kazan Mystic for Bill, not going to come in handy against the Warrior or the Warlock. Kind of just not great that he didn't pick it up against that Secret Paladin when it would have been most useful.
Yeah, I was going to say, Kazan Mystic, much, much less useful against that Warrior. No matter what kind of Warrior it is, doesn't have any secrets.
Yeah, the Kazan Mystic dies to simply one attack from a Fighter War Axe or a Death Spite.
Yeah, we do see what is popularly termed the Fiery Wind Axe in Sky High's opening hand. So very brutal against aggro, although, you know, Bill playing that Druid, probably just going to go ahead and... Oh, Harrison Jones again.
in this matchup, that's an incredible hand. Like, WTY Bill is never going to run out of cards. The Harrison is guaranteed to find a target. There's at least four weapons in Sky High's deck. Ancient of Lores. Sometimes it's not what you want in the starting hand, because it is 7 mana to play after all, so it might be a little bit slow, but when you're playing against the Warrior, you should have plenty of time to get to those turns.
Sky High running what appears to be Control Warrior, that more removal-based Warrior. Patron, where
we
is it?
Seen
can you find it?
A single Patron Warrior at this point.
Just
7
up the
Warriors this weekend and no Patrons thus far.
Right, I want to say it's like the Where's Waldo book, but it's like, where's Grim Patron? Like, can you find the Grim Patron on the map? Korra, what do you make of this complete lack of Patrons thus far?
It's surprising to say the least. Patron is a very strong deck, but you know what? Control Warrior is too. And against aggro decks, against more mid-range decks, this Control Warrior does really well. I am a little bit surprised because you have to assume that most people are going to bring Druid lists, which the Patron is better against, but if your plan is to just ban that Druid, then the Control Warrior is probably just better against the other classes overall than the Patron.
I like this better than, I thought for a second he was going to innervate out the Harrison, but I like this better. You see that he has three attack represented from the Fiery War Axe, which is not going to deal with the bear, so you can save that Harrison Jones for something like a Death Bite, which is a little bit more impactful.
Skyhead does have those double slams to be able to deal with the Druid of the Claw anyway, so it works out pretty well for him, using only half a card in the Fiery War Axe to deal with the innervated Druid of the Claw.
Did we just miss the boat on the Gore Howl? Has this been a thing that like we just didn't know about? Because we see another one right here in All Sky High's hand.
I want to point out that the prophet TJ Sanders, once upon a time, being like 3 weeks ago, did tell us that there was this deck, this warrior deck that was rising in popularity, and I scoffed at him. I was like, no, TJ, we'll only play Patron. But it's a control warrior that lacks those big bombs because you just kind of count on the removal and Elise to bail you out later. And I think this is definitely what we're seeing more and more of is that deck that TJ kind of predicted. Harrison Jones is going to put yet another Death Spite in the museum.
Yeah, but the Death Spite going into the museum means that the Gore Howl, it does not belong in the museum, and it's going to find a lot of value if the game goes long.
Well, I'm sure Harrison Jones still believes it belongs in a museum, but he's not going to get to put it in there.
Won't be putting it there.
No, but I'm actually really excited to see more of this Eversiction style removal warrior that plays Elise. It's a lot of fun to actually watch, a lot of fun to play. Very long games.
Wow, and going on the offensive there.
A little bit surprising, but such a big play. I do like the Ancient of War here, because in case that there is no Execute, and we can see that there in fact is no Execute available to Sky High, it's going to get a lot of value.
Do you think that was a response to Tank Up coming out and him kind of realizing, all right, I'm not, because again, we can't imagine that he's running double combo, so his window to beat a warrior that's just generating this much armor is much smaller than a traditional druid.
I like that theory a lot, and it looks like he did want to go for that risk, because there was a completely different line of play with just going with Ancient of Lore, being a little bit less weak to those removal effects, but he certainly wanted to go for phase. He had a 5-3 for the 6-3, so it would have been kind of favorable trade, but yeah, let's see if it works out.
Ooh.
Sky High gonna have to face tank 5 damage here.
But it's effectively 1 damage because he has a tank up, so it feels a lot better there. Gonna go ahead and shield slam off the Harrison. Empty board once again. Exactly what that control warrior wants to see.
Savage Roar coming into hand.
Okay, so there could be that one combo that you mentioned, Korra.
That would be, I mean, okay, let me put it out there. Savage Roar, you're not running Force of Nature with it, and you just use Savage Roar for those situations where you're just trying to clear big things off the board, push a little bit of damage. Is that at all possible, Korra? Is there any world where you do not run Force of Nature with Savage Roar?
I mean, anything's possible, but even in the world where you're playing the most taunt-heavy wall druid, one combo is pretty likely. So I would say yes, we're most likely going to have a Force of Nature in this list, but I'm just curious whether or not we're going to see, you know, is there a second Sludge Belcher? Is there a Senjin Shieldmaster instead of Shredders? Could there even be something like a Cenarius, which has been out of meta for so long?
But I do think that there's at least some chance that there
much success in this tournament. And, you know, we talk a lot about Shaman, Warlock, Druid, and Paladin is kind of those core classes you bring. You know, Fringe, shout out to Mage, Rogue, the occasional Priest, but the Warrior is kind of thus far, and you know, we're only on day one, but it's kind of the unsung hero of this tournament thus far.
Yeah, certainly. I didn't expect many Control Warriors in this tournament. We've already seen more. I thought we might see maybe one, max two, but we've already seen three, or maybe even four, or three or four. And it has been quite successful in the games that we have seen. Even those games that the Warrior might have not like won, it's still been looking really solid.
Right, and one of those reasons why you don't expect to see Control Warrior a lot is Control Warrior does have its favorable matchups, but Patron as an archetype is one of the few decks. We were talking about this last night, actually. You know, Patron is one of the few archetypes that does really well against aggressive decks, but also Druids. And it's usually you don't see that. Something like Handlock is really good against aggressive decks for the most part. Mm-hmm. Not good against Druids. So if this removal deck is panning out as well as, I think, Hyper Removal is what we're going to call it now. Is that the...
Something like that.
We'll confer with the others. But if it is like kind of handling all these decks as well as it seems to have been thus far, you know, it might be kind of a staple deck going forward for the rest of the winter season, obviously, before, you know, Standard comes to Hearthstone.
Yeah, I mean, we did actually see it in the first match, Chalky versus Nostum, again, take out Chalky's Druid. So it's a deck that can do almost anything, similar to the Patron Warrior. So almost what the Control Warrior needed, really, was just that sort of... that slight switch up. Since the beginning of Hearthstone, Control Warrior has been pretty standardized. Shield Maiden maybe made it a little bit different. But this is the first time we've seen a Control Warrior list that is actually significantly different and has sort of a different play style. So it's exciting to see.
Yeah, abandoning those big bomb cards that you tend to see, like, you know, even Baron Geddon, which is traditionally used for removal, if it's there in your opening hand, it feels really bad because obviously you have to wait till at least turn 7 to get it. It damages you. So when you look at why Control Warrior tends to lose to aggressive decks, it's because you get those big cards earlier and you're not necessarily getting all removal. So if you're just banking on weapons, and again, we saw Slam, Shield Slam, Bash. I mean, I don't think there's any, with the exception of maybe Whirlwind we didn't see, but like things like Double Brawl, we're seeing
Double
it just,
Revenge.
It's just pretty much you're just drawing everything you want against these decks, which is just more removal. And even against the kind of heavier decks that are playing like, you know, Mountain Giants and Twilight Drakes, you still have a lot of removal options, and Elise offers you that kind of like late game, like, please bail me out and make like big scary things that my opponent doesn't want to deal with. So very interesting to see how this goes forward for the rest of the day. Bill is so heavily favored out there on Twitter as we see that. It's you know, something like 90-10. So people are really expecting Bill to close this out. And, you know, Bill is a very popular streamer. So I'm actually, you know, those votes not surprising. So if you're out there as a Bill fan, you clearly are voting for him. Sky High, you know, he was starting to claw his way back into that one. Obviously, we're dealing with some technical issues at the moment. We'll get right back into it. But Sky High, certainly more than capable of getting back into this as he is running that powerful deck. And he's also running Warlock as well. And we haven't seen exactly what that Warlock is yet. But if it is something like Zoo, or, you know, even Reno Lock against this, again, non-combo deck from what we've seen thus far, it could actually have fairly good chances to lose to either one of those archetypes.
Yeah, it's possible. Sky High, we don't have full information on him just yet, but a big question mark here also is like, how good is this Kel'Thuzad Druid? Because I'm not saying it's bad, I'm not saying it's good, but it's a little bit of a question mark to me because you don't see that all so often, and some of the cards that are in the deck we haven't even seen yet.
It's a deck I've played some of. It's generally when you get bored of the original Druid, you decide to bring this one out just because it's a little bit more fun. I don't know that it's more consistent. I would have to say it's not. Better in an aggressive meta. I played it a little bit against Secret Paladin in the beginning because, you know, you throw out a bunch of taunt minions. You're like, haha, you can't get through to my face. Feels bad. But in a tournament setting, I don't know that it's more consistent than the mid-range Druid that we're all so used to. And that's what you want to see in a tournament. You want the most consistent lineup. You want the best chance to win. So, I mean, I'm sure Bill has done, you know, large amounts of testing with it. I'm sure he has reasons for why he brought it. But I'm still just curious as to, you know, what the overall goal of the deck is. We still have only seen one combo piece.
Right, and that's a very popular topic of discussion among some of the best Hearthstone players who are at the most tournaments is there's this almost like kind of resentment towards these people who bring these, you know, really like different decks because people are saying, oh, well, it's just strictly less efficient. Like if mid-range Druid is one of the most efficient decks and you take the kind of chalky approach, which is that, oh, it has the highest win rate, like you're obviously going to bring it to a tournament. And to your point, Bill obviously has to feel somewhat comfortable.
Yeah, of course.
But I do find myself wondering, you know, it's clear from all the taunts, aggro is a consideration, but what is he expecting to run into if he brings something like that? Because Kaltazada is one of those things where, it's very much targeted towards bringing back certain board states. But it looks like we're about to get back into a regame between these players, so we're going to see how this pans out. Regame, most fair to both players, so hop right in a minute here. And Sky High, I believe, is going to be on that Warrior again, and we're going to see what Bill does with that Druid.
Yeah, that game right there, it was fairly even. Both players still had very good chances, so I don't know like which one of these players...
It's not
a nice situation, but both the players are probably somewhat like okay and not going to be too upset going to play.
I was gonna say, in those situations, they're very unfortunate. And also, at the time, both players are like, well, no, see, I had it because, I just feel really confident there. But Cora, to your point, we saw two Ancient of Wars. That is an extremely greedy deck.
You can sort of predict that there's going to be more greed in this list, especially with the Kel'Thuzad. We just weren't sure, you know, which taunt minions it was going to be. Double Ancient of War, though, that's...
Senjin Shieldmaster.
I knew it!
It's 2014, and we're back with Senjin Shieldmaster.
Oh, I love it so much.
Das Dingo.
This is like the wall druid I played a year and a half ago, and it's so fun. It really is. You love to bring it out in a meta that you're just, it's so stale when you're playing normal druid. You want something to liven it up a bit, and the surprise factor is so huge with this deck.
Yeah, it's at times it feels like we see nothing but Pyro the Shredder when it comes to 4-drops, but there's a Senjin right there.
The original king of 4-drops here. Let's welcome back our king, Senjin Shieldmaster.
Chillwind Yeti had an honorable mention, but Senjin Shieldmaster, so good, still really great in Arena, and it's so nice to being able to see it again in competitive play.
Yeah, every so often, it's like 2:30 in the morning, and I'm like, yeah, Senjin Shieldmaster, that's better than Piloted Shredder. It has 5 health. It contested so well. And then I go and I bring out my Oil Rogue, and I'm like, all right, out Piloted Shredder, in Senjin Shieldmaster. And I go like 3 games, I'm like, get out of here, Senjin Shieldmaster.
Come Piloted back, Piloted Shredder.
I was wrong, but certainly strong in its own right. And when it comes to blocking damage, Senjin Shieldmaster blocks more damage on average, 5 health and taunt, than a Piloted Shredder does, so.
In this type of deck, it makes
a lot of sense because you're playing a lot of taunts anyway, so you're kind of like supporting that strategy. And against aggressive decks, you can start building that line of defense on one turn earlier.
Right, we do see that Savage Roar again. At this point, as you pointed out, Savitz, if you bring out that Kaltazad and you have a bunch of things on the board, Savage Roar still, even without Force of Nature, just does a lot of damage. So it's not a bad one-off. We see here he's going to go ahead and silence. Okay, so this is interesting. He silences the Sludge Belcher, and he is just getting in there. He is getting that damage going because, again, he understands once that Jeskar Trueheart comes out, he's going to be in a really rough spot in terms of trying to press any kind of aggression.
Yeah, I think this really signals it strongly that WTY Bill is not confident taking this game into the late game, and he really, really wants to just end it very early. And
just want to note, he ran the Sludge Belcher into the Druid of the Claw before brawling, so he could kill with the Deathbite if the Claw ended up living, and that's how it worked out. That's some really, really upfront play. Very, very nice.
Yeah, Sky High said that he was taking on pro players and beating them, so it's those are the kind of plays that help you get there. And all right, so for Bill, I think this is a very, very curious turn.
Uproot.
Mm-hmm. Uproot. You know, Savitz, I was actually, you cut me off at the pass. I had about like 30 more seconds of build up to try to justify this case, but you cut me off. So
Savitz can just justify it by saying Uproot.
Uproot.
Or Riot.
Well, Riot. Please don't riot on the desk, Savitz. But God, my land. Make it a quiet riot.
Okay.
There we go.
Ops for protest.
Peaceful protest.
Yeah, right. Ops for the Sludge Belcher, plays down the Darnassus Aspirant, and Bill just does not want to get caught in this situation where there's just too much armor to deal with. And we do see that Revenge lighting up, and as he is going to be at 12 health, so.
Sky High playing very quickly at this point. He is confident with his plays. He knows what he's doing, but you have 90 seconds. I mean, he's obviously, you know, just going very fast.
Yeah.
Right, and we do see here, again, the Uproot of War sitting in hand, just waiting to be uprooted.
Unfortunately, I don't think we're going to see it, at least not here.
Oh! No!
It actually looked like he was going for the Uproot for a moment.
We actually all kind of got out of our seats a little like, Uproot! We have actually seen a few uproots in this winter championship season, so it's not as uncommon, but obviously you always want to see it.
Yeah, it's such a high-risk, high-reward play. It might sometimes allow you to end the game one turn earlier, but not having that extra five toughness, I mean, it does make it weak to removal.
We did see that execute come out before, so it's one of those things where Bill probably feels pretty safe playing down that Ancient of War. Nothing makes you feel sadder than a 7-mana tree dying to a 1-mana execute, but... we are going to see the revenge come out. I need to see second revenge here.
Yeah, just like shield, shield slam.
Yeah. All right, and back to the drawing board. Bill's like, please let my things live.
Nope.
Nope. And
not quite.
The thing about warrior removal, it's just so good in the one-for-one game. You know, against Zoo, it doesn't shine as much because so much of the Zoo deck is predicated on just sticking on the board and just never going away. But for Druid, this absolutely works. And Bill's just kind of throwing everything he has into this now. And we see in his hand, he has the Wrath, Swipe, and Savage Roar. Savitz, if you're in Bill's spot, would you approach this game the same way? Just kind of like going on the offensive as this
Very
Druid.
Aggressive.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. He's looking at his opponent with 8 cards in the hand. It's really hard to, like, can adjust strategies from here. Maybe if he picked up an Ancient of Lore, it's an obvious draw, but if he was to pick up a second one, then he could consider going for some kind of trading strategy. But I would expect Bill to stick with the line that he has chosen and just keep going at that pace aggressively.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, to deviate at this point would just be a disservice to him because he is so much lower on cards and he might not have the combo in the deck. It might just be Savage Roar, so you need to really go all in with, you know, you're bored, you really need to hit face as many times as you can, and he's been successfully executing that plan from the beginning. Unfortunately, Sky High's hand is so large that it might still not work out.
We did kind of see Sky High give Bill a little bit of daylight by swinging into that Sludge Belcher and not killing it, so Bill's going to dig through and see what he can find, maybe put something together. Maybe there's a second Savage Roar we haven't seen, maybe there's that Force of Nature down there, but he's going to go ahead and clear out the Shield Maiden and just continue hitting him in the face and hoping for the best.
There was an optional play with the Mind Control deck there and skipping the Hero Power and the Wild Growth, but it kind of works out better because the second Revenge is in Sky High's hand. So if he was to play that Mind Control deck for tempo, he would have easily been dealt with by that exact card right there.
Right, so the Revenge will come out. Now we've seen two of them. Might be a safer world for a Mind Control deck to live in, but there's the Shield Block. This is actually feeling like kind of like a boss fight in one of the adventures where you're just trying to get through all the armor.
And you just can't.
Right,
it's just so difficult.
Such a consolidated win condition. Ugh, big Game Hunter nod, what you want to see?
So you play your MZ the Keeper. What a bunch of misfits right there.
Right. Hey, they do things.
They
Keeper
do things,
the Grub is really good
right
at things.
No.
Not all together, usually.
Bill just considering, do I just play them all?
Yeah, I want to see it. Please.
Do I play
them
all
in Savage Roar?
Do it.
Oh, gosh.
I mean, there's nothing in the big game hunt, right?
That's true. There's not going to be any 7 attack minions.
Okay. He doesn't go all in. He keeps the big game hunter. Which is curious, though, because if you know what this deck is, and it seems like he has a good understanding based on his attack plan, what are you expecting to need to BGH?
Right then.
That one?
Oh,
that one,
yeah.
Right there.
Hey, Rob doesn't know Hearthstone. Never mind. There we go.
No, but I'm with you. I would have totally played the big game hunter. It's looking like such a desperate situation. Just getting that extra minion on the board.
Even keeping the big game hunter against the Grom, probably not going to help at this point.
Like, okay, you kill the Grom. Now what?
Congratulations. I still have, you know, 30 health.
Right. And then you just kind of slowly die as the warrior just armors up every turn. And I mean, you're half armoring up every turn.
Like this, I feel like this is the breaking point right here. This is the moment it's like Sky High. GG. Because there's no Ancient of Lore from the pick. It's not exactly like that. There's still a chance, but the plays from last turn, like the plays from last turn for Bill, they were weak, but this is like ridiculously bad. But he has no options but to just go all in here and try to top deck something.
Sometimes the only choices are bad ones, and we see that there. Yeah. It's Force Play down the Big Game Hunter and Swipe Face. Grom's gonna come out and say hey.
I think with that Grom, what else is gonna come out is a concede from Bill.
Yeah, Bill was setting up for the combo potentially if Sky High had to hit with the Gore Howl armor up. He would have been at 14. We still don't even know if Force of Nature is in Bill's deck though, and Kalthuzad not gonna do it that time.
Right, Sky High ties up the series, and we are going to go to that game 5, and it's going to come down to Druid versus Warlock. I want to say a battle that's kind of been tested over and over, but with this Druid deck, you know, we don't know how this is going to go. We haven't seen the Warlock deck just yet, but Sky High is very close to completing the reversal. And, you know, very impressed by him so far. I really like Bill. I want to say that Sky High won, he times the series. I really like what Bill did in that last game, though. Really understanding, look, I'm not going to win this late game. I don't have the tools to do it. This is not that kind of Druid deck. I'm just going to play all these taunt minions and go very aggressively with
them. Yeah, it seems like he really knew what he needed to do there. Yep. The aggressive line of play by silencing the taunts and all that. It seemed like now that the game got quite long, it seemed obvious that his chances to win in a long game were slim and none.
And it's sort of curious, this is the age-old, you know, teacher versus student, and the student is making a comeback in this case. It would be really amazing if Al Sky High could actually come back and complete the reverse.
Be really amazing, but very unexpected, according to our poll we have out there running on Twitter. We can see people are still firmly in the Bill camp, so Al Sky High supporters, get out there and vote, because it looks like Al Sky High very close to completing this reverse sweep.
Yep. Generally, I like making predictions for an institution like this, but we literally have no idea what kind of Warlock that is.
Right.
Can't wait, because Sky High has played some interesting cards, especially in his Paladin with those eggs. So there could be some interesting cards in the Warlock as well.
Speaking of interesting cards and interesting discussion topics, I just want to bring up really quickly, when it comes to ban strategy, Warrior hasn't necessarily been the sort of deck you're banning out unless you're playing Breeze Mage. Maybe that changes as these Warrior decks continue to just rampage through everyone else.
All right, another Kazan Mystic. We've seen plenty of Kazans in this tournament, but I don't think we've seen a single successful one.
Yeah.
I wanted to see the discussion in the QQ group. It's like, Kazan Mystic? And everyone's like, yes.
Yes. Yes. Good card.
Steal a secret. I guess it's probably something you're considering more Freeze Mage.
Yeah, it's a Freeze Mage.
Right.
Anti-Freeze Mage card, and that also gives it away that the strategy is not usually to ban out their mage, but to ban out something else and just deal with the mage.
Right, I was going to say, you might expect it against Hunter, too, but Rexxar actually missed his tournament. Don't know where he is. Rexxar, I miss you, big guy.
Yeah.
Always close to my heart, but...
Piloted Shredder as well as Senjin Shieldmaster on Bill's side.
I don't know how Bill is doing this. Where is he putting all
magic.
These cards? Yeah, Bill might just be magic.
Wow.
But right now, he's got a pretty good opening against the Sky High, but again, without the combo. That's usually what makes it so scary for the Warlock player.
We can predict that the Sky High's deck is going to be a Reno Warlock because there is that Demon Wrath, and if you were running that, if Sky High was running the Handlock variant of Warlock, he would most likely be running Shadow Flames and Hellfires instead in multiples.
Right, so based on what we see, again, I think the Reno Lock, I agree with you, is the correct read here. Bill goes ahead and trades in that Zombie Chow. Gets the value, realizes, you know, the health's pretty high. Let's just go ahead and keep it up there. Not really pushing a lot of damage. And Al Sky High, the name of the game for him is just kind of tapping, getting the resources, playing things out so that he doesn't overdraw his hand, keeping the board in check, and then just winning out late. You have Reno. Reno's going to heal you back up to full health. You have Jiraxxus. So this is kind of what makes his deck very strong against decks that lack burst potential. And it feels weird to be saying that about Druid, but here we are.
Yeah, and without the Druid combo, it's so... much more difficult for the Druid to actually defeat the Reno Warlock. Usually the Reno Warlock has to be so aware of that combo that they Reno maybe a little bit too soon even. They Reno from 20 health instead of, you know, from 3 when they get the most value from it. So this is gonna make it so that Al Sky High has so much more life to play with. He might still be thinking that Bill has the combo in his deck. I mean, he might still have it. We just have not seen a Force of Nature up until this point, so we are only speculating, but it's going to be so much tougher for the Druid to actually beat this Warlock.
Right. Last play. Bill chooses, you know, he's highlighting over the Zombie Chow for a while, kind of looks at the game gang boss, hits face. Would you have done that with the Shredder Zavitz?
Kill it with that? Probably not because of the potential Mortal Coil. I like it to go more to just go face. There's some things that could potentially go wrong, like a Power Overwhelming on the Zombie Chow would be an excellent draw for Sky High. So it's a... I don't think there's a right or wrong play, it's just a kind of like hedging bets.
Yeah, Bill definitely playing very consistently over all three of his Druid games.
It's getting very aggressive, which is funny because this is probably the least aggressive Druid deck I've ever seen.
Yeah, yeah. It's a very slow one. We're so used to seeing that double combo Druid, but he is playing that slower version.
All right, so he does have the Pilot of Shredder on the board still, so he has something. You see the one imp, and of course, when you're playing against Warlock, one imp is not something at all to kind of scoff at. You could expect Abusive Sergeant, Power Overwhelming. Obviously, we saw Defender of Argus. So his way is for that imp to give him problems. But Demon Wrath, oh, wow, so he's going to go ahead and silence the Piloted Shredder.
Yeah, I like
the board.
It.
Yeah.
Against the usual Druid, you maybe want to keep that Demon Wrath a little bit longer and try to use it on something like a Shade of Naxxramas, but he knows that Bill is not even running Shades of Naxxramas, so no reason to really wait with the Demon Wrath.
This was a good turn right out of 2014's playbook. Play down this engine, Hero
Beautiful.
Power the Owl, great. You know, up next I'm expecting Chillwind Yeti to come out. All of our old friends.
Kalthuzad coming into Bill's hand really nice with that Sentient Shieldmaster, but unfortunately we see the Twisting Nether come into Al Sky High's hand on the same turn, meaning that Kalthuzad, even if it manages to get value, is essentially just gonna, all of its work will be neutralized with one card.
Yeah, such a powerful card. It does have that high mana cost on it, but destroying all the minions on the board.
Right, I think he's pondering that Keeper of the Grove, just hitting it and hero powering it. I like this, just continue to put on the pressure. The Warlock hasn't been life tapping much, so we only see five cards, which in a lot of decks, like say Aggro Shaman or Face Hunter, you're thinking five cards, that's a lot of cards. I got a lot of things I can do. But for the Warlock, if you're under, you know, eight cards, doesn't feel particularly good.
Yeah, it certainly is fewer than usually at this stage of the game.
All right, now we're Sky High. Apparently feels a little safer just going to that tapping game, start trying to find the answers he needs. That Twisting Nether is going to be so brutal against the Kalthuzad, although Sky High hasn't seen Kalthuzad yet. So that's not a card you play around either until you see it in a deck.
That's true.
And then Bill could just play down the Kalthuzad here, and it would certainly match with his agenda of just going for it and just doing the damage, because obviously Kalthuzad, six attack, that's respectable. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
but he doesn't know that would be so horrible for him.
Be a disaster, that black hole, just all those minions getting drained, and he would be left with a Zombie Child, Wild Growth, Mind Control. It's just,
Very weak.
Don't know, I would be so tempted to play the KT, but if he does play it, he's gonna have to pay the price.
Well, he's probably identified that he's playing against that Reno Lock, as you said. He saw
that's
the Demon
true.
Wrath, he's figured it out, and last turn your opponent did nothing.
Yeah,
so,
I mean, eight mana Hero Power Pass, that
sets off some alarms.
Yeah, definitely should ring some bells.
It looks like he's just going to Hero Power, and he might be playing around Molten Giant here.
Oh, that's also possible.
Yeah,
it's also very
like
likely
that's what
that,
he's doing.
Yeah, it's also very likely that the Molten is in the deck, even though we don't see it in the hand.
It's not going to make a difference, though. Lord Drax is coming out, going to set All Sky High to 15 health.
He doesn't swing into it either. Oh, no!
Wow.
What just happened?
Oh, if Bill can get the Savage Roar.
It's... No, it's not enough damage.
Okay.
No, wouldn't it be enough damage this turn, but...
Next turn. There's the Force of Nature. He has the combo.
He's running single combo. And we just
this
never
deck
saw
is
it.
So
it's
cool.
There.
And this deck has like extra spaces. I'm not understanding
it's
how it's working.
32 cards.
Oh, wow. This is, okay. Suddenly this is a very interesting situation. Although that Force of Nature. Oh, there it is. I want the mind control tech to steal the mind control tech.
There is that Shadow Flame, so Sky High does have the clear.
Do you see the Doomsayer, by the way?
I see
yes,
it.
I see what? It.
Oh, man.
Oh,
these
awesome.
Are. These are some very
There's
different
some crazy games.
Takes on the more conventional decks.
Mm-hmm.
All right, Ancient of War. Let's put out a big old tree.
Fortunately, no uproot here. Just a little bit too dangerous, especially with good old Big Game Hunter in All Sky High's hand.
Well, you also really wanted to protect the Zombie Chow. You don't want to be healing your opponent at this point, because Bill has a lot of cards.
Oh,
yep, there's a Twisting Nether.
This game is not over yet.
Not at all.
All right, we see that Inferno come out, and you know, Sky High has capped himself at 15. That's as high as his health can go, and you see the Twisting Nether. Bill, again, has so many cards, though, because he put Drax's hands in a museum.
But Sky High is getting a 6-6 Infernal every single turn. That is so difficult for the Druid to deal with.
Get the cat form. Get that damage in there, and Bill is on it.
Base is the place, and unless there's more taunts, the Roar could
Do you think the Kalthuzad turn might be coming up?
I think the Keeper of the Grove turn might be coming up.
The Keeper of the Grove.
You gotta silence that Sludge Belcher and just keep hitting him.
Yep.
You're okay. If he Doomsayers here, I think you're fine with it.
Yeah.
I mean, if you get Savage Roar, you win.
Just
killing his own Infernals, which you are having a hard time with.
You just want that taunt gone. You want those Infernals gone.
The end
All right, Sky High banking heavily on this Doomsayer.
I mean, silencing the Doomsayer seems like a pretty bad play, to be honest, because it would save the Infernals.
Yeah. Nope, you're good with it. You're like, great. I would actually just keep her the Grove and just keep hitting face.
Okay, so Bill does have a chance here to go for the lethal, I believe, with that Wild Growth if he was to pick up the Roar.
Right.
In which case, the silence effect from the Keeper of the Grove on the Taunt and the Roar
would be 11
extra
damage.
Extra 6 damage. Yeah, so I think that we can't quite see how many cards there are from here, but there's not that many cards remaining because he did draw those 8 extra, some of which did get burned, but I believe the Roar was
not
among
the cards. No, we did not see
the
Savage Roar get burned, just the Force of Nature.
Yeah, just that one Force of Nature that did not show up in any of the other games.
All right, this could be it. If he gets the Roar, the series is going to be over.
Still Wrath?
Just yet.
No, you wouldn't have the mana.
He wouldn't.
All right, what do you sound?
After the Wrath, no, yeah. I mean, after the Wrath, nope.
Do that in here. Oh. Whoa!
What? Really?
Why is he saving the Infernals for his opponent?
Oh, that seems like such a really bad idea.
Do this. Why would you not let it go off?
Bill said he would not be making any mistakes, so I have to assume he has a plan here, Zavitz.
But
he's speechless. Oh man.
Just two Infernals in the low to this. Like,
you could have neutralized your opponent's field, and he decided not to. Also missing 4 damage to the face, used a Wrath.
Speech,
it just seems like he set him up in a really awful position.
You look absolutely crestfallen.
I'm trying to find the reasoning behind this play. There has to be some reason that why he did it, but it's very difficult right now. I believe that it would have been far superior to let those Infernals just get destroyed, getting that extra damage to face. But let's see how this works out.
There's the upbeat attitude. I like it.
But it could work.
Another thing to consider is, in a very unusual turn of events, the Druid is far closer to fatigue than the Warlock. The Warlock really only left tap like twice before just jamming down Jiraxxus, so...
I've got the
Alright. Alright, Bill, let's see where you're going with this.
Face.
How does Bill win?
But he left the Keeper of the Grove up. Would you have done that?
Hmm.
I feel like that's kind of playing with fire.
Have you seen 2 Druid of the Claws?
6 extra damage, though.
Yeah, that's fair. I don't know, I just feel like you're... Did he see the Savage Roar? I think he saw the one Savage Roar in the first game of the Druid.
I think both of the Druid of the Claws are gone, yes. But let's try to find a way out of this for Bill. There's so much power on the board. He's going to go for a draw, but is there even any card that he could find here?
No. Sky High takes it.
Sky High completes the reverse sweep on Bill, and what a series.
The student has become the master.
How long were you sitting on that?
A long time.
Okay, good. Just checking.
It's been a long match. Oh, yeah.
It was a
long
good
time.
One, though. That Druid deck was really, really interesting. We finally saw the combo come out, so there was one copy of it. Mm-hmm. We just never saw any of the games, and it actually really validates all the gameplay from earlier where he was just going for it and just really trying to get the damage in, because if he'd ever gotten the combo,
he
would just close it out. So
that was an amazing series, and I believe that that Doomsayer, like Bill not letting the Doomsayer trigger, is going to be something that a lot of people are going to be discussing after the series.
So. Definitely going to go home and pull that one up later and kind of watch it and see if I understand the reasoning. But for now, it is Owl Sky High series. He takes it 3-2, comes back after being down 0-2, and Frodan is standing by with Owl Sky High to get his thoughts on the match.
For Bill, a friend, and also you're a big fan of his stream as well, you mentioned that it's also a battle between two people who are very familiar with each other. So going into it, did you know that he'd bring these kind of decks specifically? I wasn't really expecting more of that ramp defensive style from Druid.
No, we don't know each other's deck, but I guessing he's probably going to use control decks more often. Yeah.
What do you think was the reason you're able to climb back into this series? It didn't look like you were too nervous, but being down 0-2 in the very beginning is never a good feeling.
I wasn't actually nervous, but I really don't think I have the chance to win, especially how I have 3, I have Renolock and Control Warrior to against the Druid. But luckily he is not the Raw Joy, so I get more chance to win. Yeah.
There were a few plays where I believe not only the casters, but even the analysts over on the sidebar were really thinking, really wondering what was going on. Bill was making a big statement saying he wants to play perfectly. Do you feel like Bill can bounce back from this win and still get second in the group? Because I know both of you really wanted to advance.
Yeah, of course. I hope he wins.
All right, cool. Well, awesome. I guess the last question you want to ask is, how do you feel about the rest of your group here? You have the winner between Snail and Chess Dude. You already got one of the hardest victories, the first one out of the way. Do you really feel like you can continue this momentum? And if so, what are you going to do to prepare for tomorrow?
Yes, of course. But I haven't checked out their class yet. So I will look at this replay for today and prepare for tomorrow. Yeah.
All right, well, there you go. Sky High, another person able to grab his first important victory in the group. Let's over to the sidebar and see what they thought about Sky High's victory and all of its details of analysis.
Thank you very much, Dan. And what a series that was. Al Sky High coming all the way back from a 2-0 deficit. So that was the last game in particular is what we want to talk about the most. There were some interesting decisions, but the one that I want to point out in particular was the Jaraxxus play. Now, we saw it get punished very quickly, but I want to bring that up, and I'm going to come to you first, Sottle. You told me during the game that you actually agreed with the snap call to play the Jaraxxus. What went into that call that you made?
Well, basically, he played the majority of this game with a whole lot of nothing going on in his hand, so he needed to create some sort of situation where he could fight for the board with the very little resources he had in hand. Obviously, we see here the spectacular talking point, 8 cards drawn by Harrison Jones. But of course, Al Sky High comes out of this series the victor, and it's in no small part to the fact that he made that extremely brave turn 9 Jaraxxus just to start generating that 6-6 every turn.
And Raynad, do you agree with that play as well, to just snap call on the Jaraxxus going into that turn?
I mean, I definitely would have thought about it more, but I mean, after the fact, thinking about it, I think it's definitely a reasonable play. I like it because with the Shadow Flame in hand, it did give him a way to not just constantly be behind on board for the rest of the game, but actually swing it. So, yeah, I agree, Sottle. I think it's a pretty good play.
All right, and Sottle, what were your thoughts on the Ramp Druid in particular? You know, a deck that hasn't been seen very much. We've seen the combo. What are your thoughts on that?
Right, I mean, I'm trying to find a reason in my mind that you'd play that deck, but it just feels like bad Druid when you look at it, right? Like, it looks like it's just trying to do the same things, but a bit slower and less efficiently. Mm-hmm. You know, decks in the game are pretty efficient at keeping your board clear if they want to at this point, so Kel'Thuzad is a card that's hard to get value out of, which is one of the big advantages of the deck. So, really, what is that deck providing that double combo fast Druid doesn't already?
Well, it's a couple things. It has access to Zombie Chow and more taunts like Sludge Belcher, so the aggro matchup's actually a lot better. If he were to play against something like Aggro Shaman, for example, this ramp deck would be a lot better against that than a traditional Druid, which would just get stomped. So a good percentage of the time, at least. So I can see the logic behind bringing it. If you're expecting more aggressive decks, maybe like Secret Paladin, it's a little bit better against as well, I would argue. But yeah, there's a couple nuances the Ramp Druid aficionados on Ladder will tell you about. For example, you can play either the Kel'Thuzad build or you can play the combo. You usually can't play both. They don't synergize well at all. So that's kind of like in the Western Ramp Druid list, it's more of what we see. But yeah, that Harrison Jones. I mean, if Azurdrake's a pretty good card, right, guys?
Yeah.
If you play an Azurdrake that draws you 8 cards,
yeah,
something has to go pretty wrong to lose that game, yeah?
Yeah, all right. Well, great points, guys. We got to jump into the next match here in just a moment. We have one match left to go for the day, but before we get into that, enjoy some highlights from that last match.